So it's my honor and pleasure to have organized this session today. And the title of Professor Hung Kam Thai's talk is Keeping Up with the Nguyens when Poor Immigrants Return to the Homeland. Professor Thai is he is full professor of sociology and Asian American studies at Pomona College, wonderful liberal arts college on the West Coast, for those of you who don't know. And he's actually chairing Asian American studies right now. Professor Thai is also the former director of the Pacific Basin Institute, and he is the former chair of the sociology department. He received his sociology PhD from the University of California, Berkeley. His first book, called For Better or For Worse, Vietnamese International Marriages in the New Global Economy, is a study of international marriages linking women in Vietnam and overseas Vietnamese men living in the diaspora. And I actually teach from this book, and it is always a hit with the students. I don't know if I've told you that, hon. So, his second book, Insufficient Funds, The Culture of Money in Low-Wage Transnational Families, won the American Sociological Association's 2015 Best Book Award on Asia from the Asia and Asian America section. And it won a second award, the 2016 Best Social Science Book Award from the Association for Asian American Studies. Insufficient Funds, about which you'll hear tonight, examines how and why transnational families in the Vietnamese diaspora spend, receive, and give money. Okay. Professor Thai is a recipient of fellowships from the Haynes Foundation, Hirsch Foundation. There's too many foundations. I'm not going to name them all. He has given more than 100 invited lectures and conference papers in 17 countries. His current research, which you should feel free to ask him about after the talk, is a book about the different forms of social exclusions, systems of social categorization, and symbolic superiority in contemporary Vietnam. And I also just have to say that Professor Thai is hilarious. He's charming. He has me in stitches all the time. So you are going to love the talk tonight. Okay. So can you please put them together for Professor Thai?
Thank you so much for the introduction. She set the expectations too high. So I'm now kind of worried. You know, Nadia Kim is such a wonderful person, and as many of you know, a very famous scholar. I have read her work for the past two decades, and even though we haven't seen each other in about 15 years, we just caught up like we hang out every day in California. Really great to see you, and thank you so much for the invitation. I should start by first thanking the director of the Institute, Joyce Moy, who is not able to be here today because she's actually teaching a workshop herself. And then to Anthony Wong for orchestrating and facilitating my visit. And then, of course, most of all, to all of you for coming on a Friday at 6 p.m. I was indeed very worried about having an audience, so I brought my family here. You know, I'm glad to know that given the severely limited choices of entertainment in New York, that I could be your entertainment tonight. So thank you so much. Thank you so much for coming. I hope that I can provide you with some interesting things to talk about later as you move on with your life. Let me just give you a sense of what I'm going to do with the talk today. The talk is really divided into two parts. The first part of the talk will deal with the jargon and the academic scholarly literature, which I will try to sort of break down as I try to pitch the talk to a general audience. The second part of the talk will be, like any good ethnographic sociologist, will be storytelling. I will spend roughly half of the talk telling a story about a family with whom I got to know over a decade, who are part of a book that I had published not too long ago, and is the basis for the analytics that I hope to present for you that reflects a lot of the scholarly literature that I hope to point out. The topic of my talk is really about money and family life. And in this talk, what I do is I take the topic on a transnational and a global scale. For us, particularly thinking about how Asian American families within a transnational context deal with the problem of family in money. And by the end of the talk, what I hope we can do is think about the ways in which money can be a simultaneously both a devastating as well as a liberating mechanism for us in Asian American families. And I'll talk about what I mean by that in the scholarly part of the analysis. So I begin by recognizing the fact that in many developing countries today, a significant number of people rely on remittances. That is, money sent by immigrants to family back in the homeland to cover their daily living expenses. Survey data, for example, show us that in the Cape Verde, 20% of all citizens rely on remittances. In El Salvador and Nigeria, 30% of citizens rely on remittances. In the Philippines and the Dominican, about 40% of citizens of those countries rely on remittances. In countries like Haiti and Nepal, nearly 50% of citizens rely on, again, remittances, money that are being sent from their families abroad. And in Mexico and Vietnam, the country that I will focus on today, over a quarter of all citizens rely on overseas money to sustain their daily expenses. Beginning in the late 1960s, scholars, especially in anthropology and economics, have asked, what are the public policy consequences of migrant money? This is a question that interests scholars doing work on immigration, but also those concerned about macro policies regarding financial inclusions for immigrants. But today, I report on my multi-sided longitudinal study about remittances in Vietnamese transnational families and point to how immigrant remittance behaviors are linked to the precarity of low-wage labor in the United States and that which compel many immigrants to turn to the homeland in order to participate in the consumption sphere, a sphere that I argue is often denied to them given the low wages that immigrants are being paid and members of the low-wage labor force generally. There are two recent books that are important for us to think about as I continue thinking about this analytic, and some of you may have heard of these two books. The first is a book by Lazy Abrego, who's actually a Pomona graduate where I teach, who is now a professor at UCLA. It's a book that looks at the legal infrastructures that present difficulties for families to live across transnational borders, called Sacrificing Families. In this book, Abrego talks about the ways in which parents, because of the very fact of legal problems that make it very hard for them to go visit their families in El Salvador, must sustain families through money. So sending money back provides a material base for giving contact, communications, and love to their families back home. The second book, which is a book written by Roy Germano, who's actually a professor not too far from here at NYU, is a book that was published in just a few months ago, and I just wrote a review for it, a very good review for it. And in this book, he makes the argument that in many poor countries today, the governments of such poor countries rely on remittances as a form of social welfare. So in effect, what a lot of developing countries do today, as he named the book, is that they outsource welfare to the migrants who live abroad. Both are very important books, and they have echoed a lot of previous studies that have made similar arguments, but they are the first books of these kinds to make these case studies and are very important contributions to understanding and to providing extended case studies into thinking about issues that no books had done before. My work is different from these two books on another level, but before I get there, I point out that I want to show you how I locate the topic of my book in three related areas of scholarship, and I'll go back to these books. And the three related areas of scholarship that I engage with are not necessarily about migration, but they deal with really what are seemingly disconnected ideas, but are important for us as we think about the culture of money in transnational families. The first is a body of research on, generally, the social meanings of money, particularly in the past 20 years, and the ways in which we can capture monetary activities at the private and emotional levels under global capitalism. And these studies have often tried to bring tangibility to the often abstract assertions that are being made by scholars of globalization and international finance. Scholars like Vivian Zelizer, I would say, would be one of the first people to look at the intimacy of money and family life. And in this body of work, scholars like Zelizer have tried to look at the ways in which previous studies on money had ignored the social and the personal meanings of money, and the ways in which we assign such monies to monetary flows within intimate ties, in part because previous work has really looked at money in impersonal and in exclusively as a matter of looking at money as a matter of exchange on the market. The second body of research that I engage with is the new body of research that I think has emerged in the past 15 years on the transnational consumption behaviors of immigrants. Given the entrenchment of precarity and instability that define the lives of workers in the bottom of the hourglass economy that we live in today, there is a growing trend among immigrants who work in the United States but spend most, if not all, of their disposable income back in the homeland. The question is, what are the implications of this for monetary policies and for the lives of immigrants generally in a place like the United States that has seen a declining, if not a disappearance, of social welfare of various kinds? And the last body of work that I engage with is what I call the sociology of social worth, competence, and success. This body of work has been initiated by the Harvard sociologist Michelle Lamont, who has looked at the various ways that low-wage immigrants or low-wage workers generally in the United States devise meanings and even project superiority over other social classes, as in her book, The Dignity of Working Class Men, as in Michelle Lamont's book, The Dignity of Working Class Men. From an international perspective, I'm interested in how precariat workers in the U.S. face various kinds of social exclusions, especially within the sphere of consumption, and how they devise various creative strategies to buffer that kind of exclusion that they experience as low-wage workers in the United States. In terms of Asian American studies, there have been two recent books that are quite crucial for thinking about worth, competence, and success in Asian American families. And this is where I invite you to kind of think about the heart of the matter for Asian American communities. And because this is an Asian American research institute, it's particularly important for me to highlight these two recent studies. The first one, most of you probably know of this book, which is called The Asian American Achievement Paradox by Jennifer Lee and Min Zhou. Min Zhou is at Columbia University, Min Zhou is at UCLA, Jennifer Lee is at Columbia University in Upper Manhattan. And in this book, they look at the ways in which for many people in Asian American families, many young adults, that is, their choice of occupations and careers are very much underpinned by the pressures of their parents. In other words, how young adults in Asian American communities choose what kind of jobs they have are very much premised on how their parents expect and understand success in the United States. And one of the arguments they make in this book is that in the long run, this presents a lot of mental health issues for Asian American young adults because of the ways in which they misunderstand or do not talk about these kinds of expectations, and in fact, the ways in which they cannot meet the expectations of success or the metrics of success that their parents set for them. The second book takes a relational idea, which is a book by Angie Chung, who's a professor at SUNY Albany. The book is called Saving Face, takes the issue at a deeper level by helping us think about the ways in which Asian American families have disruptions and disjunctures and how we have a very hard time talking about it. And in this book, she argues that for Asian American families, one of the reasons why many family members ignore or do not talk about such problems is in order to save face, as the book implied. And one of the major issues within these kinds of contexts is about metrics of success. So when young adults choose a careers that their parents object to or find not a very good choice, it becomes a huge problem within the family, often leading many people to all kinds of mental health issues. Now, these two books have raised the issues within Asian American communities, and what I have tried to do in my book, as you hear the story when I present in the latter half of the talk, is to help us think about how do we present or define different measurements of success and competence within Asian American families? And how can we think about it in more collaborative ways in our communities and perhaps making outreach to various community members about these kinds of unreasonable success metrics that we use in our communities? Returning to the case of remittances, I want to sort of highlight to you some patterns about remittances globally. It is no surprise that for many of us to understand that giving money to relatives and family in general is a common practice within Asian American families. And this is especially true when people have family back in the homeland. Among immigrants, this is now a mundane matter, as many of us are familiar with. Surveys, in fact, show us that about 12% of the worldwide population live within what we call transnational families. That is, families in which core members, parents, siblings, and children, are living within two nation states. In many of these families, relationships are underpinned by monetary flows that amount to official estimates of nearly $500 billion in 2015, which is the latest year that we have a composite or comprehensive data for. More than 80% of this amount goes to developing countries, and in some places such as India and the Philippines, Nigeria, Cape Verde, and Vietnam, migrant money has been built into the developing countries' national budgets. And some governments now think, as I mentioned earlier, of migrant money as a form of social welfare for citizens of those countries, which is why in some places like the Philippines and India, as the sociologist Robin Rodriguez pointed out, some of these countries have now served as brokers states for migrant labor, which means that some developing countries now are actively pushing out migrants or would-be migrants to go off to work in many different countries with the intention that eventually those migrants would send back money to the homeland, which fueled the economy. If you look at this graph here, you will see that the top eight remittance recipient countries in 2015 received a total of $240 billion, accounting for about half of all remittances in that year. Except for Nigeria and Bangladesh, six of these top eight countries include mostly immigrants based in the United States. These macroeconomic indicators do not include the substantial amounts of pocket money that migrants bring back with them when they make return visits or spend as they are on those visits. These pocket transfers, or what economists call informal remittances, are estimated to supplement the recorded remittances by at least 50%, and experts speculate that in Asia, the informal money that they bring back with them may increase the reported remittances by about 80%. One of the most important patterns within the context of these migrant money is that today's remittances are generally sent and given by low-wage workers. Among immigrants in the United States, for example, only 19%, or roughly 1 out of 5, of immigrants who earn more than $50,000 a year send any remittances at all to their home countries. In contrast, nearly half, or roughly 47%, of those who earn less than $30,000 do so. In other words, the people who are least able to send money are, the people who do so often. So these low-wage workers, especially in the United States, can be seen, as some have argued, as the economic heroes of developing countries. Feminist economists such as Malia Safri and Julie Graham, using cross-national analysis of expenditures in transnational families, have argued that migrant money totals around $5 trillion annually, which includes three types of money. First, the money that migrants send from a distance via various kinds of channels. Second, the money that migrants bring with them when they make return visits or when they pull out of ATMs on their return visits. And third, the money that get invested in various kinds of investment activities such as education, real estate, that make this amount exponentially higher than $500 billion. So $5 trillion is what feminist economists estimate that remittances have total yearly as a result of various kinds of monetary flows. when I began my work, I found that the prevailing research on migrant money was quite inadequate in thinking about the complex processes of transnational money, and especially limited in the ways in which we can think about them in the context of what E. San Juan calls the deepening and the formalization of neoliberalism. The most basic problem that I see, and I still see this as a problem, within the current research is that most scholars and most research tend to be very one-sided when they look at monetary flows. And so they tend to treat money sent and money received quite separately. So typically what scholars do is they tend to only look at one side of the monetary relationship. Whether scholars at the sending or the receiving end of the remittances become the analytic, the existing research tends to be divided into two levels of analysis that I want to go through very briefly. First, the development model argues that remittances are good for poor countries because they help such poor countries with economic growth by raising household incomes to a level that otherwise could not be achieved without the money sent from migrants. This perspective points to how migrant money helped to alleviate poverty in repressed economies, whereby they can potentially solve economic and social problems associated with overpopulation, underemployment, or unemployment. Its bottom analysis tend to argue that remittances are, in fact, important, if not necessary, for development in poor countries. This is recognized by a number of countries like India and the Philippines and increasingly Vietnam, which have provided various kinds of incentives for their overseas populations to return to the homeland. For example, in many countries, and India and the Philippines are sort of the most widely known for this, and I can talk more about this in the Q&A, they often offer reduced taxes for overseas migrants to purchase land and houses. In the case of the Philippines, migration itself is often strategically brokered by the state, with the Filipino government creating various kinds of easy pathways for would-be migrants to leave to go work. And they have developed various kinds of partnerships with various countries so that it is easy for migrants to leave to go work, particularly in the low-wage labor market. So this is one of the reasons, for example, that we see in airports in 100 countries worldwide where Filipinos dominate such airports. I mean, if you go to airports in Dubai, in Paris, in Bogota, Colombia, you will see a large army of Filipino workers at the airports. This is partly a result of the collaboration of the Filipino government and the countries that I just mentioned. In contrast to the development model, the dependency model of remittances argue that migrant money increases inequality, and thus it's a very problematic phenomenon for developing countries, because migrant money encourages unnecessary consumption and that it creates widening gaps between those who have families abroad and those who don't. It also creates what some scholars call an aspirational culture of migration, whereby because everyone sees that migrants are doing so well and are able to send money back, everyone wants to leave developing countries and thus aspire to create all kinds of strategies to leave. So the result of this, such scholars argue, is that remittances create a whole culture of unproductivity among citizens who just kind of sit around waiting for the money from their family abroad. In short, such arguments argue that it generates a growing population of people who tend to wait around for the social welfare provisions of their families abroad to sustain their daily consumption. Studies using both of these models, which tend to dominate remittance studies, tend to offer three very important themes. First, they tend to focus mostly on money that is being sent from a distance. Second, they tend to look at labor migrants, that is, particularly in these conditions of neoliberalism that we live in. They tend to look at temporary and contractual workers. And thirdly, they tend to look at cases of parent absent or spouse absent transnational split households. So typically what happens is that in a poor family in a developing country, you would have one spouse or one parent leaving to go abroad to work and then to send money back home. And so most of the study tend to take the approach of looking at it from one of these three thematic levels. My study approaches these issues differently to enlarge our understanding of transnational families across the globe today. First, my work looks at monetary flows within transnational families that include immediate family members, that is parents and children and spouses, but I also include a range of other relatives who give, spend, and receive money, including cousins, uncles, aunts, grandparents, and even fictive kin, for whom the notion of family is quite capacious within developing countries. This enlarged definition of the family is, of course, something that has been a key contention among scholars looking at the diversity of immigrants and families of color generally. Second, my work broadens the methodological approaches to studying transnational families by focusing on the relational dynamics that underlie family money across international boundaries. That is, I look at transnational family dynamics in both sending countries and receiving countries, emphasizing both locations in looking at the monetary flows within those contexts. Finally, my study examines the interrelated but distinct activities of giving, spending, and receiving money to understand the macrostructural determinants that explain the personal and the social size within the global economy of personal finance. Let me just give you a sense of where I conducted my work before I move on a little bit further. As many of you know, the country of Vietnam is quite a long country. It's longer than California, I think by about 700 kilometers, so about 300 miles. Most of my work was focused in the south, particularly in Saigon, and within about 3 to 4 hours drive from Saigon, which is formerly known as Ho Chi Minh City. The focus on Ho Chi Minh City is quite strategic and important to keep in mind because most money, both domestic money and international money that goes into the country of Vietnam, go into Vietnam, and more than 60% of all capital that go into the country stay in the south, and particularly in Ho Chi Minh City. In some sense, Ho Chi Minh City is the economic heartbeat of the country. And so I use this as a very strategic methodological decision to focus on this. And then we also know that the South is where, as most of you know, where most immigrants had left the country in the past 40 years or so. And that today, recent data suggests that more than 25% of individuals living within the southern part of the country have transnational families abroad, with roughly 1 out of 5 family members relying on remittances from their families abroad. Now, the migrant respondents that I interview, all in Vietnam, are low-wage workers who return to Vietnam to visit at least 5 times within the past 10 years. They were all first-generation immigrants. 4 came to the United States prior to the age of 12. None has a college degree, and virtually all work in hourly paid jobs. They work in occupations such as being a furniture deliverer, supermarket butcher, cashier, nail salon worker, hairstylist, factory worker, hotel maintenance worker, and airplane cabin cleaner. I met men who regularly work 7 days a week, a 15-hour shifts, and I met women who worked in nail salons for 13 hours a day. For many of these workers, taking 1 day off a month is considered a luxury. The average reported income of these workers was usually $26,000. More than a quarter of them made less than $20,000. Yet these incomes put all of the respondents above the minimum wage and above the federally defined poverty level. So what this means is that none of the people I interview were quantitatively defined by the federal government of this country as poor individuals, which means that they're not eligible for various kinds of assistance that is offered to people who are categorically and quantitatively poor. Their non-migrant family members in Vietnam hold similar jobs, except the family members in Vietnam earn about 15 to 20 times less than the family members abroad. In total, I interview 46 Vietnamese Americans and 52 non-migrant family members. I met all of them in Vietnam, starting with the migrant family members, and I can talk to you about the procedure of getting to know my respondents. I also, I didn't put it up here, but I also interview roughly 23 individuals who did not have any transnational family members to understand the comparison among those who never receive any kind of money to those who do receive money, which I can talk about in the Q&A. Now, through this multi-sided and longitudinal research of roughly 7 years, I began to see something that others had neglected within the body of work on money in transnational families. Those looking at senders, I argue, of remittances point out that migrants either give money to gain status or that migrants give money out of altruism to help their families with expenditures. That is to say, migrants will argue that they love their family members and that's why they send money. Most scholars tend to kind of point that out in the literature. In contrast, those who look at the people who receive money tend to concentrate on the variability of the spending behaviors of those who receive the money. So for example, a typical economic paper, and the people who look at the recipients of money tend to actually come from economists. So a typical paper by a scholar, Edward Taylor, who's at UC Davis, explores the impact of remittances on the receivers. For example, his work looked at how remittances may alter the access to different quality of water in different regions of a poor country. So if you ever want to fall asleep really quickly, read an economic paper on this stuff. So this guy, Edward Taylor, I mean, bless his heart, and he did something that very few of us could do. I mean, I don't know if you read any of this, Nadia Kim. He used very extensive household survey data in a poor developing country and to look at the effects of remittances, the effects of money on those who receive money. He compared a subset of family with water access to another set of family without access to such water. And then he says, well, the people who receive the money have better access to water or better quality water. And to get to this argument, the studies tend to be quite extensive and quite laborious. A typical anthropological paper, in contrast, such as the work by one of my favorite anthropologists, Luis Guarnizo, explores different dimensions of status attainment resulting from variable outcomes of remittances for the sender of remittances. And so typically, a paper like Luis Guarnizo has pointed out that one of the reasons why migrants send money back is because it boosts their status within their families, or that when they return back home, they spend money a lot because people back home recognize that that is a very status-driven thing, because by spending money, you can demonstrate your success to your family members. And Luis Guarnizo has written a number of beautiful papers to kind of show this very clearly in the case of Mexico and Honduras. In my work, I show that money in transnational families has produced what I call a transnational expenditure cascade. This is my contribution to the universe. A process by which I argue comparative consumption among immigrants and their non-migrant families has taken place on a transnational scale. In the United States, research in economics, especially the work of Robert Frank at Cornell, whose work I love, points to an expenditure cascade as a process by which increases in spending among those in high income brackets will pressure those below to spend more, whether they have more money or not. When perceptions about status that are linked to spending travel down to different levels of cascades, lower income individuals strive to keep up with those above them. Thus, expenditure cascades are triggered by people's perceptions about the rewards of comparative spending, and most importantly, about who gets to set the trends about spending. So if no one at the top is spending money on expensive jeans, then the people at the bottom really don't care what are the trends about jeans, right? Jeans is a very kind of interesting comparison because it's used cross-nationally as looking at how everyone follow the trends of expenditures, because jeans have increased in prices as one of the most exponentially expensive item in terms of increases in the past 20 years globally. In developing countries, comparative spending is precipitated by redefinitions and rearticulations of what is a necessity for everyday living due to three changes. First, changes in the availability of particular goods and services. So just because you have money, if the goods are not available, you can't spend on it. Second, changes in wage compensations among people in different levels of the cascade, especially among people living in economies with highly variable incomes, even within the same sector. So for example, if you live in a developing country and you are a banker, it makes a huge difference whether you work for a local bank, where you might earn about 10% of what someone would be making if they worked for an international bank. And then thirdly, changes to access changes to access to capital from sources such as transnational families that raise and trigger these kinds of comparative spending. In short, what I argue is that what pushes people to spend include perceptions of status produced by the personal and the symbolic meanings they gain from purchases and the availability of purchases that they make in comparison to the purchases made by others. Thus, the failure to keep up with movements within the cascade, within the expenditure cascade, is perceived as demonstrating economic inferiority. So if you're living in a developing country and at any given point no one has a washing machine, that's fine. But if someone all of a sudden has a washing machine and you lack one, it is seen as sort of a deprivation and an expression of inferiority if you don't all of a sudden go out and buy yourself a washing machine as well. I argue that this kind of expenditure cascade must be seen as a transnational phenomenon to include how immigrants, that is people living in a place like the United States, spend their money on a global scale. This is a particularly important analytic because comparative spending among many immigrants today is linked not only to their attachments to the homeland, but also linked to their inability to consume in the United States because of their dismal wages. Thus, when immigrants are excluded from the sphere of consumption, which is a huge punchline of my study, the homeland offers the opportunity to be what Lisa Park, the sociologist, argue as consuming citizens. This social and financial exclusion has resulted, as many of you know, from the laissez-faire economic restructuring in the United States, the privatization of public goods, and the extreme reduction in public care from the state. So I'm going to go back and I'm going to move forward by giving you the story that I mentioned earlier to give you a sense of how transnational expenditure cascades happen in Vietnamese transnational families by concluding my talk with a story, a complex story about a man I met and his family living in Vietnam. And the story is quite elaborate. The family is the subject of chapter 8 of my book. And I'm going to tell the story. And as I tell the story about this monetary circulation behavior in the family, I want you to think about five themes. And I'm going to talk about the themes before I launch into telling you the story. The first is to think about the process by which necessity-driven consumption evolves into status-driven consumption in transnational families. The second is to think about the transnational dynamics of comparative spending. The third is to think about the meanings of reciprocity and success in Asian American and Asian transnational families. The fourth is to think about the transnational advantage for low-wage immigrants, if only temporarily, relative to other low-wage workers in the United States, such as African Americans. And then finally, the cost of this transnational advantage for immigrants. Okay, to kind of provide clarity to the story of this family, I'm gonna sort of have a few signposts to kind of remind you about the story, but I'm gonna narrate the story as clearly as I can. This is actually the first time that I'm narrating the story. Nadia Kim thought I was gonna give a stock talk, which means a talk that I've given before, but I decided to present a new case study for this talk, in part because I just want something exciting and new to talk about. But as I tell the story, if you can keep with the facts, particularly for the Q&A, if you have particular questions. I met this man named Vu, who is the subject, as I mentioned, of one of the chapters of my book. And so here I'm telling his story to make the point, again, about the scenario of the transnational expenditure cascade. I first met Vu in 2007, and I had conducted many formal interviews with him. The last time I met him was actually in 2017, but previous to that, I had met him in 2012 when I did my last formal interview with him right before the book was published. Right before the book went into my publisher's hand. At that last formal interview, I went into his studio apartment in Orange County, where I learned that Vu had recently filed bankruptcy and that he was planning to move from his tiny apartment, which he had liked, that was costing him about $1,000 a month. He was planning to move from this apartment into renting a room from a private family at half the price for $500. When I saw him on this particular meeting, he was very angry. And he had told me that he would never return to Vietnam again, and that he was in a financial mess with tons of debts, and that he was unable to pay back the debts, and hence the reason why he filed bankruptcy. It was during this interview that I got to know Vu well, and particularly about his financial records, so that he started to tell me in a very systematic way about his financial mess. And that which became the analytics for me to think about the problem of extreme financial fragility among people who give money to their families back home. Vu is a 36-year-old butcher in Orange County, never married. He makes roughly $13 an hour, or roughly $21,000 a year after taxes. He came to the United States as a boat refugee in the early 1980s with an uncle, leaving his parents and three sisters back in Vietnam, one of whom is named Jiu, who I will focus on a little bit. And Jiu, his sister, is 30 years old and works as a cleaner in a hotel in Ho Chi Minh City, making roughly $3,000 a year. Their parents lived in Vietnam until 2006, when Vu was able to sponsor them to the United States after a 20-year wait on the immigration list. As many of you know, if you are over 21 years old, it's much harder for you to sponsor your parents than if you are under the age of 21. So by the time he was sponsoring his parents, it was a very difficult process for him to sponsor his parents, which took them many years. During the years of separation, Vu's parents lived with his sister, Jiu, who helped them by working as a cleaner in the hotel since she was 17 years old. Vu began to send money back to everyone, the three sisters and his parents, since 1995, which was really the first year that people could send money back through legal and formal channels, given the embargo that was based in Vietnam until Bill Clinton reestablished diplomacy with the country. Vu initially sent about $100 a month in the mid-1990s, increasing that amount to $300 a month by 2008, which is roughly about 20% of his monthly income. In addition to sending money to Vietnam, Vu started to make regular return visits beginning in the late 1990s, when during those visits, he would give his sister additional money, or more importantly, he would spend money on them on various things, such as taking them on vacations or taking them to high-end restaurants, etc. For example, on one visit, he had bought the family a fancy refrigerator, an air conditioner, and a motorbike, totaling about $3,500. Keep in mind, he's making about $21,000 in a year in Orange County. He felt particularly indebted to the sister, Jiu, because she was the one who mainly served as the responsible daughter, left behind daughter, who helped his parents before they had migrated to the United States. In 2002, before I met him, Vu received a letter from his sister while back in Orange County. In that letter, his sister had made the very bold request to ask Vu for $15,000, an amount that would have taken him a lifetime to save, given that he only makes $21,000 a year. With much hesitation, he initially borrowed $10,000 from a friend who did not charge him any interest and said that he could take his time to return that amount of money as long as he needed. He then took $5,000 as a cash advance from one of his credit cards with an interest of about 21%, which was the first time he had taken credit card advances. After he sent his sister the money, she started on the renovation of the house, which is why she requested the money. But midway through the renovation, she had asked for an additional $8,000. and then another $4,000 6 months later, and then a final request of $2,500 so that she could buy furniture for the house. We all know that once you start with an initial amount of renovating your house, that amount only increases, right? You add the fancy doors, fancy fixtures, and then of course you have to buy furniture for the house. In addition to these amounts, Vu had taken additional advances, more than I just mentioned, to finance several more of his transnational visits back to Vietnam. After all was said and done, he had owed about $40,000 in credit card advances, so that by 2011, that credit card amounted to about an average of 22% interest. The credit card payments was roughly $826 monthly, of which $733 went into the interest and not to the principal of the credit cards. The interest alone was really over 40% of his monthly income. On one of my visits, I had been to the house, and I remember this was one picture that I had taken of the house, the house that was renovated. One visit in the early stages of knowing the family, I had been to the house, and even though it's a modest house, it is actually pretty middle class by Vietnamese standards and even by the standards of city dwellers in Ho Chi Minh City. Comfortable, two bedrooms, one bath, but it was a house that three sisters and the parents lived in, which is actually quite common. It's not uncommon for families of seven to eight to live in a 400 square foot apartment in Vietnam, a middle class family. When I asked why did he take out credit cards knowing that the interests were so high, he said to me, "I felt so useless to my family for being in America for so long and have not been able to help them out with anything big. I know some of them feel embarrassed that they have someone here but nothing to show for it." When I probed more about this dissatisfaction with his sense of achievement and asked about how others around him were doing, that is his peers in Orange County, he said, "Many people build houses for their families in Vietnam, they buy cars, and they have something to show for their time in America. One of my friends, I don't know how he did it, but he was able to build a house for his parents about 10 years ago, and his family knows my family in Vietnam, so it makes everyone wonder why I have not done the same." So let me just show you the renovations of the house, because I went back to visit the sister after the renovations were done. This is the house. This is the renovation. As you know, renovations in Vietnam, the labor for renovation in Vietnam is very cheap. And materials, of course, are comparatively cheaper, but this is a $40,000 renovation. Now, the renovations was done, so it expanded the house to roughly a five-bedroom house, four baths. I actually have stayed overnight in the house. on one of my visits. And the house, this is inside of the house. He, on one of his visits, furnished some of the materials for them. He furnished nice dining table, picture frames, Bose speakers, and nice leather. Oh, actually, this is fake leather. I confirm it's fake leather. But an aspiration, nevertheless. And fancy picture frames. So the house was quite nicely done. In the summer of 2012, when I went back to Vietnam and got in touch with his sister, Ju, and asked if I could come to see the house, during our conversation, I asked her why she wanted to renovate the house in the first place, a very simple question. She said to me, "When Vu made the promise to help me renovate the house the first time he came back, I did not think much about it. But when all the VQ, meaning overseas Vietnamese, we knew were coming back and buying land and building houses for their families, I finally asked Vu to help us because it was uncomfortable, shameful was really the right translation, for my parents who had a son living in America and we were still living in a crumbling house." After I had asked Ju, his sister, if Vu had ever talked to her about his life in the United States, particularly about his finances, she said to me, "He says he has a very good job over there as a butcher in a big supermarket and that everything in America is organized, clean, and safe. He says that he can drink water directly from the tap. He sent us pictures of his apartment and it looks very nice. And even though he is renting now, he said that he he can get a loan from the government to buy a house, but he said it is not a good time now because he is still single and he wants to have a family before he buys a house. There are two things about his sister's narrative and reply that I learned were quite crucial about transnational family money. The first thing confirms a number of studies that have shown how migrants tend to hide the harsh realities of their lives to avoid shameful social categorization, to prevent their non-migrant relatives from worrying about them, or to simply project that they have achieved success in the United States. In such transnational families, a huge metric of success is the ability for migrants to give and spend money on the left behind family members. Other studies have documented that migrants do not share stories of their harsh lives abroad because they fear that their non-migrant relatives would conclude that they in fact were trying to avoid their success and didn't want to help out. The second analysis that I found was that the temptation for migrants to make promises, especially while visiting relatives back home, is extremely high, especially given how they want to project this image of success in the United States. And given the disparity in incomes and cost of living, promises initially appear very feasible to fulfill because everything seems affordable when migrants make return visits in the first place. Returning to my interview with Vu, he had told me that he had filed bankruptcy, and this is my last interview with him, and that he was so broke, he vowed that he would never return to Vietnam again, which he only did because he had families in Vietnam. I asked him if it was the fancy house that angered him, the fancy house that his sister renovated, and that surely he knew that the debt would make it difficult for him to repay over time, so why would he be angry if he knew that he himself was pulling this money? He said that actually he was not angry about funding the renovation of the house and felt it was actually justifiable for him to take out all the debts. And in fact, he felt very proud of the fact that he was able to make the sacrifice for the benefit of only his sister, but also other networks of family in Vietnam so that they can see how successful he was living in the United States, which would make his parents very proud. So instead, he was mostly angry. Again, he was not angry at the renovation. Instead, he was mostly angry because he had learned through his networks of kin and friends that his sister was spending money that he was sending her on, not on the food, which he had intentionally had sent money for on food, but on unnecessary expenditures. In his own words, and I'll leave him with the last words, he said, "I found out my sister has had a maid in her house for more than 2 years, and all this time I've been sending money thinking that they just needed allowances to buy food. I was so furious about it. I think it's the principle of it that got me angry. I had to wonder if they were starving themselves, or did they get a maid so that they can show off to their neighbors? It's just stupid. I am so broke right now. And when I found out she was lying to me all this time, she had not told him that she got a maid. While I've been slaving away and borrowing money, it doesn't make sense to me." So I'll leave you with his last words, and I'll take questions and comments and thoughts.